Ready?
So apparently they're having some trouble with the camera. So if you're not seeing the church, that's why. But yeah, if they sort it out, they'll sort it out. But otherwise, we'll be stuck with the screen. We'll see how it goes. Just letting you know that we're aware.
Yes, we are. And welcome to worship at Good Shepherd Anglican Church on Treaty 6 territory in Edmonton. You're here live and happy that you're here. If you are joining us from home, chat, if you're having any technical difficulties, we work hard to improve our technology each week, and guys, it is still a service. We'll begin shortly at the sound of a bell. Please take a moment in silence to be present to you wherever you are as you come into this time of worship. Of the kingdom and healed every infirmity.
Oh come,
let us worship. Our open are at home or wearing a mask in person, which should be everybody, speak with the city bylaw. You are invited to join in singing. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please join in singing the Gloria. Let us pray. Stir up, O Lord, the wills of your faithful people, that richly bearing the fruit of good works, we may by you be richly rewarded. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for readings from God's holy word.
A reading from the book of Proverbs. A good name is to be chosen rather than great riches, and favor is better than silver or gold. The rich and the poor have this in common. The Lord is the maker of them all. Whoever sows injustice will reap calamity, and the rod of anger will fail. Those who are generous are blessed, for they share their bread with the poor. Do not rob the poor because they are poor, or crush the afflicted at the gate, for the Lord pleads their cause and despoils of life those who despoil them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please join me in praying Psalm 125 by reading the verses printed in bold. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but stands fast forever.
The hills stand about Jerusalem.
So does the Lord stand round about his people, from this time forth, forevermore.
The scepter of the wicked shall not hold sway over the land allotted to the just, so that the just shall not put their hands to evil.
Show your goodness, O Lord, to those who are good and to those who are true of heart.
As for those who turn aside to crooked ways, the Lord will lead them away with the evildoers, but peace be upon Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the letter of James. My brothers and sisters, do you with your acts of favoritism really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ? For if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a poor person in dirty clothes comes in, and if you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothes and say, have a seat here, please, while to the one who is poor you say, stand there, or sit at my feet, have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters, has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs of the kingdom that he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into court? Is it not they who blaspheme the excellent name that was invoked over you? You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. For the one who said, you shall not commit adultery, also said, you shall not murder. Now, if you do not commit adultery, but if you murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged by the law of liberty. For judgment will be without mercy to anyone who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith, but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise in body or spirit and sing in heart or in voice the hymn that announces the gospel. You are salt for the earth.
Salt for the earth, O people, salt for the kingdom of God. Share the flavor of life, O people,
life in the kingdom of God.
Bring forth the kingdom of mercy,
bring forth the kingdom of peace,
bring forth the kingdom of justice,
bring forth the city of God.
You are a light on the hill, O people,
light for the city of God.
Shine so holy and bright, O people,
shine for the kingdom of God.
Bring forth the kingdom of mercy,
bring forth the kingdom of peace,
bring forth the kingdom of justice,
bring forth the city of God.
You are a seed of the world, O people,
bring forth the kingdom of God.
Seeds of mercy and seeds of justice
grow in the kingdom of God.
Bring forth the kingdom of mercy,
bring forth the kingdom of peace,
bring forth the kingdom of justice,
bring forth the city of God.
stand a pilgrim people, bound for the kingdom of God. Love our journey and love our homeland. Love is the kingdom of God. Bring forth the kingdom of mercy. Bring forth the kingdom of peace. Bring forth the kingdom of justice. Bring forth the city of God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there. Yet he could not escape notice, but a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first. It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home, found the child lying on the bed and the demon gone. Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon toward the Sea of Galilee in the region of the Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. He took him aside in private, away from the crowd, and put his fingers into his ears, and he spat and touched his tongue. Then, looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately his ears were opened, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one, but the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, "He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, through the name of Jesus Christ, we want to thank you for this day. Thank you for the church service that we are having. We thank you for the Holy Spirit that is leading us. Thank you for bringing us together. We call upon you to continue revealing yourself to us through your word. And may my words be acceptable in your sight. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. In this amazing passage of two miracles that we heard from our gospel reading, I asked this question: what are you doing to embody the healing grace of God to this fallen and failing world? The first miracle is the healing of the daughter of a Greek woman born in Syrian Phoenicia. This woman whose daughter Jesus healed is described as a Greek, born in Syrian Phoenicia. The area where she lives is called Syrophoenicia. In Matthew's gospel, she is called a Canaanite. In short, she is not only a resident of an undesirable place, she is a woman marked by a disadvantaged heritage in those days. But as more, she is called a Greek. It likely tells us more about her religious roots or lack of them. It is not a compliment. In short, Greek means she is anything but Jewish. She is thus a Gentile, one the Jews regard as unclean. More to the point, however, the woman belonged to the race of Jews, a race that the Jews held accursed. Neither of our two New Testament evangelists tells us anything about the woman beyond her plight and her plea. However, her approach to Jesus is in itself revealing. Despite the fact the woman was a foreigner, she already knew a great deal about Jesus. Nor is it surprising that she did, for her native land was the geographical center of the New Testament world. Consequently, caravans were constantly crossing its borders with news of what was happening in Palestine. Thus, like many among her neighbors, she must have followed with profound interest reports they brought of Jesus's activities. As a result, to the concerned mother, he was the embodiment of God's love in the world. The depth of the woman's confidence is evident in the manner in which she addressed Jesus on catching up with him. She kneels and bowed at his feet, showing great respect for our Lord and Savior. Our story for the morning is about one woman who was drawn to Jesus. She came to him for help, not for herself, but for her daughter. How long the woman pressed her appeal, we have no way of knowing. But one thing is certain. Not only did she believe in Jesus' ability to heal her daughter, she was determined to persist until he did. Moreover, she did so without once asking Jesus to divert his steps to the house where her child lay. So far as she was concerned, all that mattered was for him to give his word. This account is also found in Matthew's gospel, where she made somewhat a nuisance of herself. "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David," she cried out. "My daughter is severely possessed by a demon." Her unrestrained tone made the disciples uncomfortable. "Send her away," they said to Jesus, "for she is crying after us." The disciples were embarrassed and uncertain how to deal with her. In Mark's gospel, Jesus' reply to her pleading is, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." This uncharacteristic answer from Jesus is rooted in Jesus' mission to the Jews and not at this time to the Gentiles. Remember that some Jewish people refer to Gentiles as dogs. In Matthew's gospel, we read, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." Jesus himself was in an uncomfortable position. This woman was a Greek Gentile. If he thought this reply would discourage this woman, he was wrong. She was a courageous and a remarkable woman. She is clever, she is cool, but most of all, she is a loving mother who will do anything to help her sick daughter. The depth of the woman's confidence is evident in the manner in which she addressed Jesus on catching up with him in Matthew's account. She called him Lord and Son of David, titles distinctive of the true Messiah. It was a striking witness spontaneously made, and those standing by could not have missed its significance, reflecting as it did her faith. Having thus openly acknowledged Jesus as the long-awaited Messiah, the woman proceeded to plead her daughter's case. She knelt at Jesus' feet and begged him to heal her daughter, and yet Jesus gave her a rather uncharacteristic answer to her pleading. "It is not fair to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." It's hard for us to believe that such an unkind remark came from his lips. We know it did not come from his heart. Maybe he was testing her. If it was a test, she passed with flying colors. "Yes, Lord," she said, "yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Jesus was in a bind no longer. He knew her heart was genuine. In Matthew's gospel, we read, "O woman," Jesus exclaimed, "great is your faith. Be it done for you as you desire." And her daughter was healed immediately. Her heritage, neighborhood, and station in life made no difference to Jesus. And this, there is an unpleasant life lesson for the Jewish leaders, who seem forever to be following the Lord with their critical spirits, ever on the alert for his ever-perceived mistake. What we see through this woman's interaction with Jesus and his with her, and the subsequent miracle, is that God does not show favoritism, Romans chapter 2. It confirms the powerful truth that this gospel, which we as Christians are privileged to hold in trust, is to the Jew first and also to the Greek, Romans chapter 1. Jesus, the Jewish Messiah, reveals himself to a non-Jew, indeed even a woman. It runs against every tradition the Jewish leaders hold dear. I return to our opening question. What are you doing to embody the healing grace of God to this fallen and failing world? Are we open to welcoming new people into our congregation and into our life, regardless of their race, color, or who they love, or where they are from? Can we offer the healing grace of God through the life, death, resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ? And remember, he calls us today to continue his ministry to the least, the lowest, and the lost, whoever they may be. The second miracle further underscores the demonstration of no favoritism by Jesus. The subject is a man whose deafness produced a speech impediment. Jesus meets this man about 20 miles away from where he healed the woman's daughter. The place is called Decapolis. It is a cosmopolitan region where educational opportunities and medical staff are available to anyone who wants them and can afford them. Business is conducted there by well-dressed city residents who leave their homes and servants each day as they make their way to the heart of the prosperous business district. We might even imagine that this man travels to Decapolis, having been struck by deafness before his childhood speech patterns were fully developed. We can suppose that he was not born deaf, because in this era, to be born deaf would mean that one would develop no speech abilities at all. Such a person is sidelined from the mainstream by family members who realize society regards its birth defects as evidence of God's judgment. But we know that God does not work in this manner. But someone brought this non-hearing man to Jesus. Jesus took the man aside in private, away from the crowd. And Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears, and he spat and touched his tongue. Can't you see the expression on this poor man's face? He probably wondered, what's this guy doing? But he did not resist. He submitted himself to the way of Jesus. And that is the key to successful living, regardless of your station. Are you open to Jesus's touch? Jesus' compassion for others was so great that he could not turn aside those who were distressed, but he needed time for his primary mission. So he asked those who brought the non-hearing man to him not to tell anyone. That was a simple instruction. Don't tell anyone what happened here. But Mark tells us that the more he told them not to tell, the more they kept talking about it. After all, people were overwhelmed and amazed. He has done everything well, they say. He even makes the deaf hear and the mute speak. The story of the Syrophoenician woman and the deaf man are intricately linked because they demonstrate Jesus' willingness to upset the expectations of the world and welcome all into God's love. The lesson of these two miracles is to show us the gospel has power for all people and in all places, regardless of heritage or life station. The really big question or lesson, however, is that Jesus is being revealed as more than a Jewish Messiah. He is the Savior of the world. From beginning to end, these two miracles present Christ's power for all to see, just as we also see from the beginning to the end of his ministry. When God came into the world in the form and the flesh of Jesus Christ, The world was turned upside down. Throughout his earthly ministry, Jesus time and again demonstrated that all people are worthy of God's love. His work and words testify to the fact that the Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in love. Jesus did everything he could to embody how the Lord is good to all. God's compassion is over all creation. Jesus even went so far as to carry a cross on his back, walked under the ridicule of the world, and died to defeat death. Remember that healing comes totally because of the grace of God. It is a free gift purchased by Christ's death at the cross. In light of these two miracles this morning, the basic question posed by Mark's accounts is this. What are you doing to embody the healing grace of God to this fallen and failing world? Are you making a difference for God in this community where you reside, in this office where you work, in this family where you live? How best do disciples of Jesus lift up Christ to this world? These are the questions we need to ponder this week as we go about our lives. Amen.
Please rise in body or spirit and let us confess our faith as we say, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. As we come into our time of intercessory prayer, I invite you to adopt whatever position you find most prayerful, whether that is standing, kneeling, or sitting.
For peace from on high and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our administrator, Alex, for our bishop-elect, Stephen, and for all the clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Elizabeth, our queen, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city of Edmonton, for every city and community, and for those who live in them in faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In the Anglican Church of Canada, for Linda, our primate, and for the Diocese of Kootenay and Lynn, their bishop, Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In our diocese, for the retired clergy of Edmonton, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In the diocese of Bouye, Beringenier Parish, and their rector, Evariste, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Among Treaty 6 and 8 nations, First Nations, for Alexander First Nations, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For good weather and for abundant harvests for all to share, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who travel by land, water, or air, for the sick and the suffering, especially Dan and Jennifer, for prisoners and captives, and for their safety, health, and salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our deliverance from all affliction, strife, and need, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the absolution and remission of our sins and offenses, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remembering all the saints, we commit ourselves, one another, and our whole life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites us to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
If you are in person, I invite you to share a distanced sign of peace. You can make a peace sign or I love you in sign language. You can wave. If you're at home, please do type your greetings of peace into the chat. We are very happy that you are here. All right. Good morning again and welcome to worship here at Good Shepherd. If you are visiting today, we're very happy you're here. If you would introduce yourself by typing into the chat if you're at home or by introducing yourself to us after the service, we would love to get to know you. It is a delight to have you with us as we celebrate God's healing power and mercy. A few announcements this morning. It was such a treat to bless backpacks for the upcoming school year last weekend. If you weren't able to join us, please do pick up a special prayed over pencil in the narthex of the church that will remind you of God's love and our love throughout the year. We also ask you to show that love to the neighborhood around us as we continue to collect school supplies to be donated to needy students throughout the district. The collection box is also in the narthex. Welcome Back Sunday will be next week. While we won't be able to celebrate in our usual way, I have been mourning over some of the pictures of the bouncy castle that we won't be able to have this year. We will have a number of festive surprises as part of our service, so you are warmly invited. This week, outside in the kids' check-in area, Raylene is beginning her fall series on the Ten Commandments.
And all children are welcome to join her on this journey through God's 10 best ways of living. We don't stop learning about God when we become adults. Bible study for adults of all ages begins Wednesday, September 15th at 7 p.m. on Zoom. Join us as we seek to refresh our spirits in the power of the Holy Spirit as we read the book of Acts. I am sad to have to announce that the ordination and consecration of the Reverend Stephen London as the Bishop of Edmonton on September 18th will now have to have quite a limited capacity of in-person congregation. I know that many people who are here were looking forward to attending, and I ask you to join us on the live stream. While COVID is changing the way that we practice our faith and the way that we gather as a community, we remain overjoyed that God, who is faithful, has called this bishop for such a time as this. We celebrate his ministry and all of our ministry as a diocese, and I invite you to join in prayers for him and his family. Please do watch your inboxes as future announcements come out about worship restrictions and other public health measures. This is a time when the safest thing to do keeps shifting. And so we will all have to be very nimble to keep up with changing circumstances. This parish will always follow the requirements of the City of Edmonton and the Anglican Diocese of Edmonton, and very often will have additional strategies put in place by our own leadership. Your weekly roundup that comes to your email every week is the best and most up-to-date way to keep an eye on our mask requirements and other things. Speaking of which, I don't know about y'all, but I am extremely weary of all of these pandemic changes. And the best way forward for us as a whole society is for all eligible teens and adults to be vaccinated against COVID-19. If you have not yet been vaccinated, I encourage you to do so as soon as possible. If there are barriers in your way of any kind, childcare, rides, shift changes, and coverage, please let me know. There may be ways that we can help you as a church, and we do want to help you if you are having trouble. For all other announcements, please do keep an eye on your weekly roundup. Are there any birthdays or anniversaries amongst the in-person group to be blessed today? If you're at home, please type your birthday or anniversary or whatever you're celebrating into the chat, and Stefan will be glad to offer a prayer for you. If you're in person, please raise your hand and let me know. Peggy, all right. Well, let's say a prayer for Peggy, shall we? For your mom. What's your mom's name? Jacqueline. All right. Well, let's say a prayer. Oh God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servant Jacqueline as she begins another year. Grant that she may grow in wisdom and grace, and teach her to trust in your goodness all the days of her life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Thank you so much to everyone who continues to.
Lord, please also bless Kathy for her birthday, and Hunter, may they have a blessed year and feel your presence and grow in their relationship with you. Amen.
his love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring all of us to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there. I cannot give accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that. Death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Let us pray. Great and holy God, accept our offering of labor and love. May we bring you true and spiritual worship and be one with you. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. We give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. In our unending joy, we echo on earth the song of the angels in heaven as we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. give thanks to you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you have made known to us in creation, in calling Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new, and bring us to that city of light, where you dwell with all your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Creator of all, you gave us golden fields of wheat, whose many grains we have gathered and made into this one bread. So may your church be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Dear Jesus, we believe that you are truly present in the most holy sacrament. We love you above all things, and we desire to receive you into our souls. Since we cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into our hearts. We embrace you as being already there and unite ourselves wholly to you. Never permit us to be separated from you. Amen. Thank you.
spirit and truth, pouring out the oil of love as my worship to you. In surrender I must give my every part. Lord, receive the sacrifice of a broken heart. Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring to so faithful a friend, to so loving a King? Savior, what can be said? What can be sung as a praise of your name for the things you have done? Oh, my words cannot tell, not even in part, of the debt of love that is owed by this thankful heart. You deserve my every breath, for you paid the great cost, giving up your life to death, even death on the cross. You took all my shame away, there defeating my sin. Opened up the gates of heaven and have beckoned me in. Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring to so faithful a friend, to so loving a King? Savior, what can be said? What can be sung as a praise of your name for the things you have done? Oh, my words cannot tell, not even in part, of the debt of love that is owed by this thankful
invite you now to rise in body or spirit as we offer our prayers of thanksgiving following the reception of Holy Communion. Let us pray. Father, your word and sacrament give us food and life. May we who have shared in holy things bear fruit to your honor and glory. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord. Amen. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. May the God who shakes heaven and earth, whom death could not contain, who lives to disturb and heal us, bless you with power to go forth and proclaim his gospel. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Please join in singing in heart or in voice our closing hymn, Pour Over Me. Into the world, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.